Good afternoon and a warm welcome to SCAD Define Art 2017 and the annual Jacob and Gwendolyn Knight Lawrence Lecture. I am Storm Janssen van Rensburg, Head Curator of SCAD Exhibitions. Before I begin, I would like to extend our gratitude to the Jacob and Gwendolyn Knight Lawrence Foundation and its president, Dr. Walter Evans, Dr. Evans is a treasured member of the SCAD Board of Visitors and a generous benefactor of the SCAD Museum of Art. Today's lecture is presented by Hank Willis Thomas, the creator of not one, but two exhibitions at the SCAD Museum of Art. The first, titled Freedom Isn't Always Beautiful, is a concise overview of works from 2003 to the present, on view in the Walter Evans Center for African American Studies. The second is a new site-specific commission for the SCAD Museum of Art titled Blind Memory, displayed in the jewel boxes on the exterior of the museum. A self-proclaimed archaeologist of visual culture, Thomas sparks critical discourse about identity, history, and public culture. He opens hearts and minds, shares new perspectives, and encourages us to consider what he describes as, quote, the cultural hybridity that exists in all of us. Thomas has exhibited throughout the US and abroad, including the International Center of Photography in New York, the Guggenheim Museum, Bilbao, and his artwork also appears in numerous public collections, including the Museum of Modern Art, the Whitney Museum of American Art, and the National Gallery of Art. And just 2 years ago, he co-founded For Freedoms, the first artist-run super PAC. What a profound pleasure to have him here with us to share more about his practice and recent projects. Please join me in welcoming our honored guest, Hank Willis Thomas.
Thank you. That's Storm. What about the other part? What about the other part? The other part I asked you
Which
to talk about.
Part?
The other part. When we were backstage where I said, don't read that stuff. Go ahead.
But I should read it again. I should go back and not read it again.
No, just say something. Please.
It's really amazing to have you here.
No, that's Welcome. Not good enough. So, well, what I wanted him to say is that I'm the reason he came to the U.S. because I first got to meet Storm when I was working on an exhibition in South Africa at the Goodman Gallery, where he was a director. And I think, I just might have broke the mic. Sorry. I think he just loved our conversation so much. He's like, I got to really see where this guy's from. And I think I think the reason that I was able to have this show in part was because he loves me so much as a person, not particularly my work. But he's so formal. It's weird. Hi, everybody. There's so many. And Storm said also backstage, there's a lot. It's a handsome crowd. And I have to say, he is correct. Who here feels handsome? And beautiful. I like to see everyone's hands raised. Let's see that. Dr. Evans? Yes. I mean, I think it's critical. My mother says that, you know, beauty is a battleground. You know, who gets the right to claim themselves as beautiful is actually a political thing, and it's actually something that we often take for granted that we should really take more seriously, because who is seen as beautiful actually is seen as valuable in our society. And And I'm gonna keep talking because the cord just broke, maybe when I dropped the mic. I think with my own self and my own work, I'm always thinking about value and how value can be created through, don't touch it? Okay, wait. Okay. Hey, Jose. And it's so great to be here in this exhibition. I think we were just talking yesterday about how this is such a unique thing. I've traveled all over the world and exhibited, and so has Jose, and so have a lot of the other artists had major museum exhibitions. And this one is special because the community that we're in, many of us went to art school. Jose even went to SCAD. And it's just amazing to see a museum exhibition in a place of learning that is, we say world class, and I feel like we're honored to get to show together and to share our work and experience as artists with you all, because I can say I was not a student like you guys. Can I touch it yet?
Yes.
Okay. I don't say that often, I swear. But there's artists like James Baldwin are a major inspiration of mine. And I did a five-channel video installation called The Person is More Important Than Anything Else. And I'm going to just show you an excerpt from the very beginning of it because it really sums up a lot of the things I'm thinking about.
It seems to me that the artist struggle for his integrity must be considered as a metaphor for the struggle which is universal and daily of all human beings on the face of this terrifying globe to get to become human beings. What we might get at this evening if we are lucky, if the mic doesn't fail, if my voice holds out, if you ask me questions, is what the importance of this effort is.
Now, when you were starting out as a writer, you were a black, impoverished, homosexual. You must have said to yourself, gee, how disadvantaged can I get?
Oh, no, I thought I hit the jackpot.
Oh, great.
It was so outrageous, you could not go any further, you know. It had to be, so you had to find a way to use it.
James Baldwin, who are you?
First of all, I'm speaking as an American citizen. I'm speaking as also as the grandson of a slave.
My mother was born in Maryland, my father was born in New Orleans, I was born in New York.
Someone who represents a very complex country which insists on being simple-minded.
I mean, that to me is just the beginning of this work, but it sums up so much. The artist's struggle for their integrity should be seen as a struggle for all people to get to become actual human beings. And so within my own work, I see myself as constantly challenging myself to become the best self that I can be. And recognizing that I come from this really rich and incredible and challenging history, but also the simplifications of that that often actually make certain problems even more complicated. And one of the things I think about is this idea of equality that this country was founded on. And I've had to come to accept that equality is not something that will ever fully be achieved. It's something that this balance that we have to constantly keep working towards and keep adjusting. And I say the road to progress is always under construction. And my work is really very much in the legacy of both of my parents, but especially my mother, Deborah Willis. And I've this is the second time I've done this. I've started off a talk with a picture of my mom naked. Can we turn these lights down so they can really see my mom naked a little bit? And it's really part of this. It's awkward for me. I found these pictures in an old archive of hers. I'm assuming that was me in the middle. Well, she says that it's me. The text, you can't really read it, but I think it's so important in the context of a student and a student in an art school. She was a photography student and one of her professors. So I think, well, the piece says, one of her professors said, oh, as soon as you graduate, you know, why are you even here? As soon as you graduate, you're just going to get pregnant and have a baby. You're just taking the place of a good man. And she felt really offended by that. And then actually a year after she graduated, she got pregnant and had me. We can keep those lights down. It just says, thank you. It says, a woman taking a space from a good man. You took the space from a good man. And then she says, I made space for a good man. And I think that was really paying homage to me, but I really think that was really more fascinating is how her as this little black girl from Philadelphia actually took her own curiosity, which started actually when she was a junior in college. And she was really interested because in her photographic studies classes, photography was barely seen as art then. But when she'd asked about African-American photographers, their professors didn't really know much. And as any good professor would suggest, they suggested she do an independent study project to do their homework. But they said, and so she wrote this independent study proposal. It says, Black's contribution to photography in 1840, 1940. And it says, I found no standard art history that refers to, I'm going to have to stand over there. I found no standard art history that refers to Afro-American artists. References have led me to more references, which were scanty. I've written 50 letters to possible resources and have had enthusiastic feedback by receiving letters from extending invitations to visit the collections below. And she found at that time about 11 African-American photographers. You can see some of them are written in. Along this, the time that she was working on this project, I was born and got to witness this amazing journey for her to publish her first book, which was Black Photographers, 1840 to 1940, a biobibliography. What's so important for us to think about, especially in the context of a building that's this was built 13 years after that first representation of photography through the lens of an African-American, is that most of the stories we know about African-American history prior to 1865 are only about abuse and slavery, and there's this assumption that there was a uniform black experience. But when you think about African-Americans creating photographs as early as 1840, which meant that you had to know physics, you had to know chemistry, you had to know mechanics, you had to actually have the means to be able to study these things and be literate, and also the interest as an artist and as a creator to bring these things into being. And so that forces me to rethink American history. And this came out of her research as a student. And so that book led to her next book, which was Black Photographers, 1940 to 1988, which led to another book, and 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 another book, among very many more. And this is what happens with the work that you're starting now. You know, my friend and professor Chris Johnson used to say that every artist is really in search of their own specific question. And my mom's question was like, where are these African-American photographers? And if it weren't for the work of hers and like Dr. Evans actually doing the research that academics aren't actually thinking about, having this curiosity, we might not have been able to learn so much about American history that was written out. So she really was instrumental in creating a realm of photography and photographic history and art history through her work. And then I found myself following in her footsteps, thinking I was doing my own thing. And this was me, I think, my junior year in high school, in college. I don't have that hair anymore. And I did wear overalls, and I do miss them. But I was really always fascinated with the frame and the lens, and thinking about how what's going on outside of the frame of a photograph could really inform what happens inside of it. And so when I look back at my earliest photographs, and this one was my part of my portfolio when I applied to college, and I saw there was a frame within a frame, and then I started looking at the images I was taking when I first started college, and there was always a frame within the frame. And then eventually, over time, I started to actually ask my classmates if they would pose with me, and I could bring frames into the studio, and then I'd give them frames and go out into the streets and to the cities and actually try to make this commentary about what I felt like was the manipulation of photography through what we kind of arbitrarily chose to frame. And so that really led myself to actually see myself in kind of this relationship with my own mother's work. And I do look a lot like her, as when I can't go almost anywhere, including here, people say, you know, I met your mother. When my mother was here last year around this time. Yeah, so she's always 2 and 10 and maybe 100 steps ahead of me. But so this is a piece that we did called Sometimes I See Myself in You. And this kind of relationship of being interested in photography, but also through research, is what really I'm inspired by, but also popular culture images like this from an American Apparel ad that says Africa. I'm thinking about what are the roots or interests in creating images like that and images like this. And I found through my interest in photography and history is that it's connected to this. How many people know who this person is?
Burt Williams.
Yes, this is Burt Williams. And who was Burt Williams? So Burt Williams was one of the first African-American millionaires and one of the most successful and well-known people of his generation. And this is how we knew him. And what was so fascinating to me was how he was celebrated for his I had made rich for his performance of blackness on stage and the way he chose to perform and represent blackness off stage. And this idea of kind of what happens when we take on other people's assumptions of who we are, how we can be rewarded, but also what are the long-term negative ramifications of that? And what is this kind of idea of blackness that can't, that has to be performed if it is so authentic? And so within my own work, I'm also thinking about myself and looking at other artists like Sanford Biggers, who thinks a lot about hybridity and complexity within identity. And I've been making works like the piece Zero Hour, which is in the gallery, where when you're looking at it straight on, it's blurry, and then from the side, it's clear. And this idea of needing to negotiate, much like a photographer has to negotiate a space in order to create an image, I try to ask myself and viewers to actually think differently and do either maybe the mental energy of recognizing kind of the complexities of things. This was one of the pieces from that first show that I worked on with Storm. It was called A Place to Call Home, Africa, America. Because as an African American, I'm often asked, where do I come from? And I'll say New York. And then people say, well, what about before that? I'll say, Virginia. And they're like, what about before that? And I'm like, I don't know. And this idea, I've traveled a lot to Africa, and I've traveled all over the US, and I can't say I've felt especially more home anywhere. And so I realized that maybe the place I come from is actually within, all of us come from is in our minds. And so this, I created Africa America as this kind of geographic reference to my place of belonging. And thinking a lot about that, I look back to historical archives, like this picture of, it's a drawing of the slave ship Brooks that was used in the 1780s in the abolition movement. I kind of used the old absolute ad campaign language to talk about something that I think is really fascinating, which is race itself. To me, the craziest thing about blackness is that black people didn't create it, that Europeans with a commercial interest in dehumanizing people had created blackness, and that meant that they kidnapped people from Africa, which is a huge continent with millions of people with thousands of cultures, religions, worldviews, packaged them into ships and sent them halfway across the world and told them they were all the same. And 500 years later, their descendants are still trying to figure out who they are. To me, that's absolute power. This creation, so I think of race as the most successful advertising campaign of all time. When you take so many different and diverse, still even today, existing cultures and put them into this monochrome identity, I think you lose a lot, but you also gain a lot by being able to do what Sonia Sanchez says, that don't even let them call you millennials. I don't know what it is, because as soon as people label you, they get to start telling you about how to act and who you are. So really thinking about the complex ways that we can identify ourselves. But and for me, part of my interest was in, because I grew up in the age of MTV and commodity culture, was I could use advertising as this language and thinking about logos as our generation's hieroglyphs and thinking about how they're so limited in their use because they can say so much with so little, but it's almost always in service of selling. And what many of us have learned and what a lot of you guys are learning is this, how to create this and speak this incredibly powerful language, and what if we use it to speak and share our own ideas rather than just being limited to corporate agendas, which are sometimes necessary, but they shouldn't be the overpowering way that we communicate. But I think a lot within my work about how I can use this language to talk about how slaves were branded as a sign of ownership, and how today we live in an age of branded consciousness, that even as I speak, I'm advertising for Apple and Nike, or I can't talk to my mom unless I talk to Apple, and all of these different ways in which my understanding of who I am and where I am is located, in a sense, through my relationship with a major corporation. And thinking also about how idea of ascension and success for so many people is chained through sports and entertainment, or even how bodies of the ancestors of a lot of people who are celebrated for their hang time and are treated now, and thinking about this kind of society, this spectacle then and now, and going back to the conversation of slavery with the door of no return in Gory Island, which was a door that many slaves passed through, many of them ending up here in Charleston and other parts of the Western Hemisphere. And wanting to, again, bring that connection to talk about what happened on land like this, but may now be football fields versus college sports, which is a multi-billion dollar industry that's fueled off of the free labor of the descendants of slaves and sharecroppers, and often working on the same very fields that their ancestors did. And this connection to commodities like cotton and merchandise within that realm. But also within my own personal experience, revisiting, this is a picture I took at my cousin's funeral, and he was murdered because he was visiting my grandmother in Philadelphia, and someone saw these guys that he was with, and they robbed the other guys for their chains, and then they just robbed my cousin of his life. And I tried as a photographer, thought it was my duty to document his funeral, and he was literally my life plan. He was my big brother, and we lived together, even shared a room, shared a bed at the time he was murdered. And and all of a sudden I was lost without like a plan, without him. And I was trying to process those emotions, and it took me years to look at these images. And I say I stopped being a photographer in earnest when I took this picture because I couldn't say enough. And so I later revisited it with the language of the MasterCard Priceless campaign and talked about this other side of this priceless idea, you know, picking the perfect casket for your son. Even when we're mourning, we're still being marketed to. There's this unspoken suggestion that, you know, you couldn't afford to love him enough if you buy the $2,000 box of wood that's going to be thrown in the dirt, never to be seen again. Or you love, you know, them more if you buy the $7,000 box of wood that's going to be thrown in the dirt, never to be seen again. And either way, in the context of my family, it was going to go on a credit card. So you were actually going to be paying interest on this debt of your own pain. And so these are the issues that I try to address in any number of ways. I was fortunate enough to be able to put it out in the public and have different responses, which I can't show you today. But it's when you take work that's personal but seems public and put it out into the public, you actually have to be accountable for the ways that people respond to it, which is really challenging because a lot of people thought this was an ad, and they also thought that it was racist because it was kind of labeling the African-American community in a certain way, and having to defend and talk about the work was really challenging. But it also was an opportunity for me to grow and to expand my own process. But that really, his murder, as I said, changed my life. I started graduate school 6 months later. I was applying to school that week that he was killed. And there's this haunting thing, especially because we used to joke and laugh that as African-American men, we made it to 21, which was like seen as kind of like, because there are many opportunities, not opportunities, many times when our lives were put in danger, whether it be by peers or police. And there's this thing, and we knew many of people who were killed, but it could have been you, it should have been me. I started making these pieces that are lenticular, that you'll see one in the gallery, but they reflect on this kind of thing. It's all your fault. It's not my fault. This idea of this changing kind of value. And a lot of the work that I've been doing, it's really is about this context. And this piece, which is called I Am the Greatest. Anybody know who the greatest is? And what to me is amazing about the greatest is that this person at the age of 22 years old told the world that he was the greatest. He didn't say, I'm the greatest boxer. He just said, I'm the greatest of all time. And then spent the next several years proving himself right. And what does it mean that someone born in the segregated South of very little means could decide to the world, I am the greatest? And even as they faced public scrutiny as their body deteriorated and they became in a lot of ways a shadow of their former self and even moved on to the next life, they are still the greatest. So when I say I am, you know, there is a power in that I have to really, really recognize. And that's when you say I am, you should really think about that because that's what you have to live up to, you know. And so I say I'm a person. I don't say I'm an artist anymore. And that work is this ridiculous and audacious that I wanted to make a pin that was larger than life because these pin back buttons are kind of corny because you're wearing your heart on your sleeve when you wear them, right? But I really wanted to make them art because when you call something art, all of a sudden you are allowed to look at it and think about it more, and talk about it more deeply. And so those things in the gallery are actually pins. I dare anyone to talk the storm and try to put them on. Or maybe President Wallace will take the insurance burden of. but there's so the pin back buttons are really. I'm looking back at historical archives and pins. Keep the faith, baby. Or this is the ANC, South African political party's pin. A pin that I found in South Africa that was actually created in solidarity with the people who were victims of genocide in Chile. And so recognizing that there are also these global struggles. And so as you can tell, my work has taken a lot of changes over the years. That's because I graduated in 1998 with a degree in photography and Africana studies from NYU. And then about 3 years later, the entire medium of photography changed. That digital cameras became ubiquitous and Photoshop got much more advanced. And so everything I learned technically in school was irrelevant. And so I was stuck. I was like, I could either learn it again. I'm like, I'm not doing that. Or I can just try to do what I do, which is what I learned in school was to actually think critically about things that we take for granted and think about, look at our visual culture. And so I started to actually experiment in other mediums as a way for myself to stay relevant, but also maybe, I wonder if I were a better photographer if I would have kept taking pictures. But anybody want to? No, you don't think so? I mean, it's that, because I do want, sometimes deep inside, I'm like, maybe I'm just lazy. But I think that I'm not. That's what I'm telling myself. But because I've started to appropriate, and we talk about when I grew up, when I was in photo school, appropriating was stealing. You know, it's just like, oh, you can't take a picture of yourself, you're going to use someone else's. But within the context of myself looking at the archive and rethinking my own relationship to photography, because there are more pictures taken in a single second than any of us can make sense of in our entire lives. And I started to think about myself as maybe a visual culture DJ or an archaeologist who needs to actually use we as a society need people who are actually looking at the images that we're creating to think critically about them so we can look at where we're going. And this is a picture I found in it's a mirror, as you can see, like the ones in the gallery, but it's a picture of apparently Public Enemy Number One in 1965 in Los Angeles. And to me, it's astounding that the headline in Life magazine with this said, Two Little Prisoners. And what does it mean to see an image like this in any context, in the land of the free? How did that shape these boys' relationship to the police? When I think about protecting and serving in the context of an image like this, I struggle to find the reality, whatever realm where this picture needed to be taken. And so I think I started to look at historical images and put myself and ask the viewers to put themselves in relationship to them. Pictures like this of Amelia Boynton, who in an activist in her 50s who died at 109 in 2015, still in the struggle and fighting for human rights, fighting for the rights of all Americans to have equality and the right to vote. I start to really think about this tension and made a series of photographic mirrors based on photographs by a photographer named Spider Martin, who photographed Selma March, where hundreds or thousands of people marched from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama for voting rights. And Congressman John Lewis, as a young 20-something-year-old, is in the front of that. But you see, this is March 7th coming up. It was called Bloody Sunday in 1965, the day when the police tried to, I guess, enact American justice on the people who were actually fighting for the very same thing. And this question of when or do we stand up for what we believe in? When do we tell the government that we think they're wrong and we're right? How do we do that is always kind of something that we have to contend with. But I think I've been really amazed by the images that we see today in the news and in the public and how they seem so close to images that we saw 50 years ago, and this kind of way in which the past is present and mayor of Atlanta later, Andrew Young, and but also thinking especially about how the South, which was this fertile ground for change and progression in the United States, after the success was made, so to speak, all of a sudden it seemed like there was a vacuum. And now all this territory was ceded, where you had people who were walking collectively, they not necessarily because this person identifies as an African-American, this person still walked 50 miles on one leg for what he believed in and didn't necessarily have to feel like he was, quote, a part of that community to actually participate in that. And because I think we all need to recognize that the struggle for equality is on all of us. All of us have that potential of being, in this picture I love of Martin Luther King laying down, you know, which is not an image I saw. Like, we think we create these cartoon characters of our heroes that they were always morally right. They were always in the right place, you know, and doing the right thing. But seeing him reclining with people around him reminds me, you know, and you could see a little bit if you get closer, like his shoes were beat up. You know, that these are real people who were just taking what they had to actually make a difference in our society. And other people who had their own opinions, really dignified, I think people who thought they were good in their own society, in their own way, were responding to that. And so looking at ways that people come together in contrast to forms of oppression and aggression have really been inspiring to me. But also looking at South Africa, where I think is so similar to the United States in its history of pioneering and segregation. I look at images like this by a photographer named Catherine Ross, taken in 1990 of a person who was arrested, well, several people, as you can see, are arrested, and this person put their arm through the breathing hole of a police vehicle, not knowing if, you know, I can't even imagine doing that, knowing that the person on the other side might just decide to break my arm. You know, and knowing that no one will probably care or ever see, you know, that I'm making this gesture, and or know that it's me if they do. And how do we take images like this from the past that actually still have currency and meaning and present them in a new way? I tried to do that through actually turning them into sculptures and thinking about what Roland Barthes talked about as the punctum, the thing that pierces you within a photograph, that sticks with you. How do I actually get myself and the viewers to actually find a new relationship to these moments and actually think of them in a broader context? Because to me, this is still like photography. It's still cropping in a way. But also looking at other elements of the photograph and representing that. And all of the things that we choose to focus on, whether it be what become our version of the truth, our version of reality. And these collective movements for human rights, what I found in South Africa, which took place when people were burned their passbooks collectively, although that meant that they were at risk of going to up to 5 years in jail because they didn't believe what the government was doing was right. Or images like this, which I always felt guilty looking at, by a photographer named Ernest Cole, who took a picture of minors being strip searched. And I felt guilty because I was gawking at their butts. And like, how can I represent this image in a way that isn't further creating this humiliation? Question, can you imagine what it's like to actually be on the land of your birth, going deep into the bowels of the earth to get little nuggets of metal that are more valuable to people than your own life? You know, so this little rock, they're afraid that I'm gonna steal it and make money off of it. So they put me in a context where I am seen as criminal when, you know, it's, to me, it's just crazy when I think about the way value is created, when we think about cotton and tobacco and rice and indigo and the same systems that often happen all over the world, even today, where people's value of life aren't seen as valuable. I created this piece, I recreated it and titled it Raise Up. And I wanted to give it a new meaning and a new relationship. And 6 months after I created this piece, the events in Ferguson, Missouri happened, and it was seen in the United States as the hands up, don't shoot piece. And so this work about something that happened 50 years ago, another part of the world spoke so eloquently about something that was, I guess, apparently about to happen in another part of the world. And to me, that's also what happens when we look at images and think about them, things that should have never happened and should never happen again. When you look at them cropped and reframed in the way through this kind of process, you start to recognize that maybe those same things are happening again and maybe happening now and may continue to happen if we don't actually recognize and learn from the past to talk about the present. Or situations where people, like in 1989 in Berlin, Germany, where Storm also lived, you just like to go to places that, where there's tension. I can see that now. No, seriously, I'm like, it's funny, I'm like, storm. But it's, I spoke to somebody who was actually a white South African, Afrikaner, who Storm is not a fan of, as an artist, because he feels like the work is racist. But this person, who does not think he's racist, told me that he was in Berlin in 1989, and that was their first time as a grown man he'd ever heard the name Nelson Mandela. Because we trust our educational system so much and our government so much, but we also have to be conscious of what they're not telling us. And so he was at a rally. They were like, we're going to this rally for the South African guy. You should come. You're South African, right? And he went, and he was like, wait, who is this guy? And no one had ever heard of Nelson Mandela for almost 20 years. And so thinking a lot about that, think about what happens when people come collectively and say they've had enough. What happened in Berlin when the people had enough and the government had to bend again to the will of the people. That was so powerful to me. And so I made a sculpture inspired by that and thinking a lot about the Sistine Chapel and the creation image, and also thinking about how all of these references to the past and the present and to the future can happen through a work of art. Even especially thinking about sports, which is this incredible fertile ground for social change, although it's seen as being so superficial. And thinking about the Harlem Globetrotters, who've been active for almost 100 years, and how through the creativity, actually, of these athletes, they were able to actually help make this sport a national, international phenomenon. So I created this piece, Liberty, which was really kind of inspired by that photograph. And so I'm often looking back at images that kind of are seen as kind of boring or from the past and trying to give them new meaning so I can learn myself and think differently about things that I might dismiss and take for granted. I think a lot about something that I saw in a movie when I was, I think around your age. It was called Head of State. It was with Chris Rock. And there's one line in it that really changed the way I saw myself as an American citizen. I think Madam Gandhi talked about this idea of failing forward. Is so important. So if you don't have a question, you have a statement.
You answered my question, actually. I was going to ask for advice. I didn't graduate.
So the question is, after you graduate, where to go from there? Go where your heart takes you. I mean, you could start a college. You could work at a college. You could probably even start a country. The question is, how creative do you want to be? You know, there's this idea often that we have to know what we're going to do in life, but assuming, which is probably a bad assumption, that you're going to keep on living, you should actually try to live every moment to bring you joy and to do the things that you love and things you believe. I graduated thinking I was going to, like, I don't know what I was going to do. My plan, as I said, was to work for my cousin, and then he was murdered. And there went that plan. And I went to graduate school because I didn't want to pay back my student loans. And so I was like, if I'm in school, they can't charge me. So, and I stayed in school for 4 years. And as a result, I got to know a lot of people. And then all of my first 4 or 5 shows, including my gallery, Jack Shaman Gallery, which I still work with today, came from college classmates who graduated ahead of me, and they were like doing stuff. And they're like, I know this guy or that guy. And literally that's how my career started. So I say, if you wanna be an artist as a career, don't be realistic, because the chances that you'll be successful aren't realistic. And then once you get successful, you probably won't know what to do in the first place. So really try to actually challenge yourself every moment to and you're sitting next to a great artist right there. Ray Parla, Jose's brother, so he can tell many stories himself about his journey, which took almost 15 years to actually get the degree, but even more to build the career. And like, I mean, if you were selling artwork out of school for more than 10 years, you were really kicking butt. You know, and it should, so you shouldn't be thinking so much about that, but as much as how do I feed myself spiritually. But this is...
Our American children's futures are at stake here. Now, I say we need to study this issue and appropriate legislation that will return us to an America that we can be proud of. God bless America, and no place else.
But that one line, it says, because when you say God bless America, that can only be what you mean. You know, that if, and no place else. And the challenge of that is, like, what happens to the rest of the world if we don't care? Because we have to recognize that what we do here does affect everyone else, and vice versa. So this patriotism at some point is probably going to actually run its course. And I think about even the way it has always not worked for the people. So I made this quilt, which is made out of decommissioned prison pants. It says "We the People," but it's a maze, and the stripes are also reminiscent of the stripes of the American flag, which, again, in the land of the free, we imprison more people than anyone else in the world. To what odd? To what end? And we have corporate and private prisons. So it actually, and even in the public prison system, it is a business. It creates jobs. So I struggle, actually, even in the context of my love and joy for this country and all the great things that it stands for, but actually how do we keep recognizing that we got a lot of work to do? And part of that is to actually look back, and I'm often inspired by the words of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the president, who in his Four Freedoms speech said that everyone is entitled to four basic freedoms: freedom from want, freedom from fear, freedom of worship, and freedom of speech. And these were this was the groundwork for the framework for the argument for human rights, and also the argument to go into war, and the argument to actually imprison American citizens of Japanese descent. So at the same time that the president, who had these lofty ideals, was making this incredible promise, he was also undermining it. And I think that contradiction can exist without us actually demonizing anyone, because even every great thing I've ever said or done, if I have said any, there's probably one to two to a million ways that it could be undermined by something else I've said or done. But these ideas of always moving forward is so important to me. And so I, along with a group of friends, created a super PAC called Four Freedoms, but it's F-O-R Freedoms, because we are standing for freedoms that we may not even actually personally agree with, but the idea that if we believe in freedom, we should be willing to have this discourse. And so fine art is an incredible place, because we live in the landscape. That's freedom is our, that's our territory. And we've ceded it so much to people who aren't creative. And so I decided that I wanted, along with my colleagues, to actually create a space in politics for creative thinking. And so we started off with an exhibition at Jack Shaman Gallery, and two exhibitions at Jack Shaman Gallery. We did installations all over the country in about 18 different states, including Georgia, with Melissa Messina and Flux Art, Flux Projects. looking at this sign that this police officer made, who would have ever thought that that's who made that sign? And looking at all these other signs that people make and putting them out all over the country was really amazing, but also was amazing when we made several billboards, but this one especially, and put this in along Route 80, actually in Pearl, Mississippi, which is the same highway that they marched on in Alabama, and appropriating the language of our president's campaign, Make America Great Again, caused a pretty big stir, because people in the African American community and many other people thought that this was put up by a right-wing group that was saying, Make America Great Again, you know, put those people back in their place. But for me, the Making America Great Again is actually looking back at all of these courageous Americans who, with violence, love, faith, and courage, stood up with nonviolence, love, faith, and courage, stood up against the violence of the police and humiliated the government into momentarily granting human and civil rights. And this idea of making America great again, if there was ever a time that America was more great for more people than it is today, it was then. But I don't think it's ever been greater for more Americans than it is today. And so our challenge with the PAC and with the projects that we continue to do all over the country is really to create space for ambiguity and questions and challenges that don't make somebody a good guy and somebody a bad guy per se, but actually ask us all to rethink what could really be interpreted. And that, for me, happens within other work projects like the Truth Booth, which are platforms for myself to and my collaborators to create space for everyday people who don't see themselves as artists to participate in the art-making process when they go into the booth and they share their truths.
The truth is I am a tomboy and I hate pink and I hate princesses. That's the truth.
And I love young people who don't want to live within the borders that society has created for them. And we first took it to Ireland. We took it all over the United States. This is one of the young people in Detroit.
The Muslims that are so-called terrorists are not Muslims. Please believe me. I am a Muslim myself. The Muslims are kind and nice people. They are giving and they pray to God 5 times a day, the same God that you have, the same God Jewish people have, the same God Christians have. We're all the same. We don't need to hate. This is a free country, and we should be good.
And so what's so fascinating with the Truth Booth is that like I, as an artist, get to be a spectator and get surprised.
The truth is not to be discovered because it was there before we were born. It hid itself when we were born, and it only comes out again once we are dead. I'm nearly dead, so the truth will shortly emerge.
I believe the truth is the struggle to find what it really is.
The truth is really small, it's very hard to see, but if you look really, really close, you will find the truth, and it's all around. Thank you.
It is true that I've got a girlfriend that is named Rian. And it is true that my favorite animal is a dolphin, okay? And that's all I wanted to say.
The truth is, Molly, you're a bitch.
The truth is that I want to be an actor, a dancer, a singer, but I'm not sure how to get into the business. I've joined Trading Faces, and I've joined the agency of Zaire, but I'm not sure if I'm going to get into the, well, I am in the agency, but I'm not sure if I'm going to get anything out of it. And I just really want to be an actress especially, or maybe a beautician, or a singer maybe, or maybe a dancer, but I'm not sure how to get in. That's the truth. This was an Accident Keen production. I want to say hello to Melody, because she's my little doggie and all my other pets. And my parents. Peace out.
The truth, I believe, is Lego. Lego makes you think small, but believe big. Lego is in all our minds. So the truth is very, very small, but think big. This is my truth. Thank you.
So, I mean, that little 12-year-old just blew my mind. You know, that the truth is Legos. The truth is what you can imagine. It can be something so small that it allows you to think big. And I think for me, with all my work, it is about this idea of us embracing our own truths and not arguing over my truth being better or worse or more important than yours, but actually creating the space for you can have your truth, I can have mine, but we are still going to exist. And so I wanted to share a few more that we actually created were found, I should say, in New York, because each place we went to, we saw new perspectives, and New York was so rich.
The truth is that yesterday I came out to my mother as being somebody who is fluid in their sexuality, and that was a really scary thing. So I think that the truth is that we need to be more accepting of people for who they are and the ways that they are. And yeah, the truth is love, and that's all that matters. Well, the truth is, actually my truth is kind of sad. I've had 3 miscarriages, and actually one of them was a stillborn baby, my son. And I guess my truth is that I don't want to try anymore. People, always hopeful, people that know my story, people that know me, always say, don't worry about it, it'll happen. But you know what, that's not my path. So my truth is that I just hope people stop asking me, because I'm good with it, okay?
The truth is, I don't think we need a cure for autism. I am an autistic child, so, and I know what it's like to be an autistic, but many people sometimes don't recognize that. I got a great education at a special needs school, and I feel as if I'm like other kids and only defined autistic because of my history in the past.
The truth is that I never look at myself in the mirror because I get depressed about it because I feel like I'm so ugly. And even if I'm in yoga, I'll just try to avoid the mirror. And if I'm washing my hands in a public bathroom, I'll just avoid the mirror. And I thought, don't touch that, Quincy. I thought maybe that if I said this out loud into a camera, there might be other people here who never like to look in the mirror either, because I've never told anyone that, and I figured this is a place to tell your secret.
The truth is, I've tried to end my life 5 times, and every time I don't succeed, I feel better about myself, and I've overcome it, and I don't wish I was dead anymore, and that's the truth, and I'm happy that I'm a bigger person now.
I mean, every time I experience this, and all of the other footage that we collected, thousands of people have gone in, and we are so, I mean, they are so generous to be vulnerable in public, to share their most difficult stories, their most incredible insight, and all of you have that, you know, and you are artists. These are people who don't see themselves as artists. They're kids who we often dismiss. They're old people who we often dismiss. They're poor people who we often dismiss. And this person, when she just happened to be standing that close to the camera, so we can't tell who she is. And that's also the kind of chance that plays into this work. But I always felt guilty showing this because I thought it was like a really sad thing. But my collaborator, Will, and the importance of collaboration is the different perspectives. He said that, no, this is actually really inspiring, that this is a person who's saying that she's faced a really serious challenge several times and that she has actually finally overcome it, and that she wants other people to actually learn from her own experience. And hopefully a clip like this might actually affect someone else who might be struggling with the same issue and change their life. And so I'd like to end with one piece that's actually in the show, which is inspired by this photograph by Ernest Cole of hundreds of people standing collectively in 1968 holding signs that say, I am a man. And to me, that was powerful because I thought it was crazy at the time I created this work in 2009 that just 8 years before I was born, it was necessary for people to stand collectively and affirm their humanity, especially because the phrase I grew up with wasn't I am a man, it was I am the man. And I was fascinated about how it went from this collective statement under segregation in places like this, literally here, to this selfish statement after integration. But I really like to read the last line as a poem. And it says, I'm the man, who's the man, you the man. What a man, I am man, I'm human, I am many, I am a man. Because I realize that the greatest gift that any of us are given is our consciousness. It's the most incredible thing because just by being able to say I am and recognizing that power, we can always do so much and actually do infinite things. And so thank you guys all for coming and standing up and being and allowing yourself to be your best self and encouraging others. And so if we can end by taking one moment to look at the person next to you and say, I am, and finish that sentence. And do not use your name.
Thank you.
I'm going to sit here awkwardly. And there's another friend from school, Joseph Del Pesco, who's speaking tonight. Stand up, Joseph, who is also a, I always get curated by shows who I went, people I went to school with or people who love me. So it's not the art, I swear. Does anyone have any comments, questions? Ali has the microphone.
I'm coming.
Hey, I was wondering just for, out of curiosity for myself, how do you photograph something that is controversial and not speak to just people who believe what you believe, but rather to speak to the people that don't believe what you believe? Like, how do you go about making art that is successful in that way?
I have had many experiences where I made work with a very specific intention, like the one I showed you of my cousin's funeral, and not knowing at all that it would be offensive to people. Or when we made the Make America Great Again billboard, the last thing we thought was that people would think that it was, seen as offensive and racist. And so I can't, even in the times when you think you're speaking to quote unquote your people, you have to be willing to recognize that they might have a different interpretation, and everyone can have a different interpretation to your work. So what I do, the most that I do can do, and sometimes I fail, apparently, is when I make something and I put it out in the world and I show people, the first question I ask is to people who I trust, is, does it suck? And I say that because I want to hear like the harshest criticism. And if I hear incredibly harsh criticism and I still like it or still believe it has value, then I feel comfortable putting it forward. I'm like, is it racist? Is it sexist? Is it? And if for some reason I think it's still okay to do if it has all of these red flags, I must really believe that it has a value. And so for me, I try to make work that I can stand up to, and I use my peers and as a focus group, because more often than not, people are not going to tell you the harsh things. They'll tell you the things they like. So I try to really cultivate hearing the harshest thing first. But thank you for your question. And what's your name?
Brian.
Nice to meet you.
Hi. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit more about timelessness in your work, because I feel like we kind of assume photographs are like the perfect capture of a specific moment and a specific time, and I feel like you have so much that talks to the kind of timelessness of issues and events.
That's just luck. And there's Tracy Reese, who's also speaking tonight. It's just amazing when I see people that I know from New York and California and South Africa and other places in the world, and they're like all here. Like, you guys are so, and people who I actually really admire and love. So it's so weird, you know. And so I think maybe I'm just lucky that I just happen to be in the right place at the right time. I don't know, but I think the reality is that you can't rely on anything you make mattering. There can be a war started tomorrow and everything in this building can disappear. All I hope to live on through, and the work lives on through, like my cousin, is through my impact on the people around me. And so it's not so much about this specific image or this specific object. I think the people who collect my work are really supporting my ideas. Definitely not trying to make money. but that's the real truth of it for me, is that I hope that it can be relevant, and sometimes stuff is irrelevant, and then decades later it becomes relevant. I think about Jack Whitten, who's a very successful painter now in his 70s, and he has a show at Haus und Wirth in New York, and these pictures are selling, paintings are selling for $300,000, $400,000, $800,000, and you look at the label and they're like, painted 1965. And like, he kept that painting for 50 years. He kept that painting for 50 years that no one cared about it. And so how do you, you know, I mean, what do you, you know, how do you, you can't, it's, you know, you can't, you have to believe in yourself. If he had, I know other people who threw their work away because that no one likes it, it doesn't matter. You know, and later people might have come and asked, and, you know, and so that's what's, and we have artists, two artists today, who are, one is 95 years old. He's born in 1923, so now he's 93, gonna be 94. And I mean, you have to be thinking in a timeless way with your work. That I'm gonna have to like stand up and be with this thing for the rest of my life.
We have time for one more question.
I was curious, Hank, if you could talk to us a little bit about your collaborative process. You're such a natural collaborator, and I think as artists and young creators, that's such an important part of what we all need to be doing. So maybe not even on an artistic level, but in general, if you could speak to that a little bit.
Well, collaboration is really critical to me because I don't know how to do a lot of stuff. And, you know, and by nature that I might have a good idea, but, you know, I may not have the practical or technical understanding of how to make it real. And if I ask, sometimes I hire someone, but if someone's working for you, they're less likely to share and express their real thoughts and ideas because they're just trying to feed your agenda. But when it's a collaboration and I think when I make my own work, it all always kind of looks like me. But when I collaborate with people, I see myself in many other people's processes, ways of working, their cultural and historical experiences. It is always frustrating to collaborate with people because you're not gonna always agree. You're not gonna always put the same amount of work in to it. You're not gonna actually have the same thing that you wanna get out of it. But I think that's also like every relationship, that it is this kind of negotiation that challenges you to be like, you know, this is what I want. Well, this is what I want. Well, how do we actually, in this kind of tension, how do we actually make something that, you know, people will appreciate? And I think Question Bridge, which is another one of my collaborations that I would have loved to share, but are these kind of things that come out of this miraculous kind of tension and generosity that people are saying, I'm gonna share all my love with you. And also, like sometimes it's gonna feel like hate, you know, because I'm trying to think about a time when like, you know, you're like, I really want this and I really want this, or you came in late and we're gonna do this and we did, and I put all the money up. And you didn't, but it's just like, does it matter? You know, when people see, if people see it and it affects them, like how, that's to me the thing that's really amazing. And I guess I learned the need for collaboration through like just being a part of a family where people are always, you know, looking out for each other, doing things and sharing things, and me being the product of that. So thank you all for everything. And I'll be here. And I saw Madame Gandhi gave out her email, which is Madame Gandhi, G-A-N-D-H-I, at the end of her talk. My email is hers. No, I'm joking. My email is hank@hankwillisthomas.com. And so feel free to reach out. And thanks again.